everyone. Hello, Unitarians, and everyone else who's on a complicated spiritual journey. I join you in that journey. It's really great to be here. Thank you, Carol, and everyone who's pulled this together. I want to acknowledge my colleague, Maya Kassoff, who helped me with the speech tonight, who's a really smart recent college grad looking to do environmental work. Hint, hint. So, as Carol mentioned, I was honored to be appointed by President Obama to be the regional administrator for EPA Region 2. And just earlier today, my replacement was announced. And get this, he's pretty good. I mean, it's the first positive thing I can say. Pete Lopez, current assembly member from Schoharie, has been very positive, we know him, very positive on the environment. And one thing that's not on his official bio is he was an intern for me at Environmental Architects. So I wish him well. You will never hear the following sentence cross my lips. Thank you, Trump administration, for making a good appointee. That's singular, not plural. So that was a little bit of good news that is really countered by so much bad news going on. Carol mentioned I had the privilege of doing a lot of work in Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands, and I just can't tell you how my heart breaks for what the residents there are going through. Most of these islands won't have electricity for months. Most of the islands don't have drinking water. They're running out of food. Sewage treatment is not working. And before our eyes, we are seeing a humanitarian crisis unfold. And it's just incredibly upsetting, and it pains me to say that the way Donald Trump is handling the crisis in the U.S. Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico is Donald Trump's Katrina. And I know that once people are able to get flights out of the Caribbean, many people will permanently relocate to the mainland United States. So, in essence, this is our first experience in the United States with climate refugees, and it won't be the last. Let me shift the mood. So, early in my tenure at EPA, I was very excited to get an email one day. Let me tell you, EPA, you get a lot of emails. And I was invited to the White House for an ethics briefing. I'm like, oh, that'll be cool. So the presenter was a guy from the White House Counsel's Office, and he lectured us very seriously about how there should not be one ethical scandal, one ethical mistake in the Obama administration. I was a political appointee, so by definition, politicians would call me and ask me to do particular things. And that actually didn't happen nearly as much to me as it did when I was in state government. So the word was, if anyone calls you, if you're asked to do anything, if your radar goes up, call me immediately and I will help guide you through the situation. Here's my cell phone, here's my home number. And I really appreciated that, and I'm such a Girl Scout, I probably would not have had an ethical scandal anyway, but for that message to be driven home so fiercely, I think was important, and I don't think that message has been driven home in the current administration. The single biggest problem in the Trump administration is ethics. And if you have dirty politics, you will have a dirty planet. EPA Administrator Scott Pruitt is the worst EPA administrator in the agency's 47-year history. He is dismantling the agency on a daily basis. He goes into work every day and ignores the climate crisis that is unfolding before our eyes. He actively promotes the fossil fuel industry, the chemical industry, and he is rapidly unraveling policies that took the EPA 47 years to put in place. We know Trump's not getting his agenda through Congress. dismantling federal agencies. And we don't have time to waste on climate change. This year is on track to be the second hottest year on record. Three of the most powerful hurricanes ever to hit the United States have been just in the last month. Puerto Rico and Virgin Islands are in critical condition. Wildfires were spreading through the West. I have a friend I was with recently who lives in Montana. He said a big chunk of the summer they couldn't go out and easily breathe because of the Western wildfires. The fundamental problem is sustainability. We are not serious as a nation about sustainability. Every environmental problem comes back to the following statistics. The United States has 4.4% of the world's population. The United States uses 30% of the world's natural resources. We use 20% of the world's energy, and we create 40% of the world's waste. Just look at the Rack Road landfill as evidence. I'm the first to admit that the Obama administration made a few mistakes. We weren't perfect. I think we were slow on some important things. But I really miss no drama Obama. There are still career civil servants working at the EPA who are working really hard every day to protect the environment, but it's hard when the top of your agency is going in a completely different direction. Last week marked the 8-month period of the Trump presidency. When it comes to the environment, I cannot point to one positive accomplishment, not one. So the first 8 months have been an environmental disaster, and the next few months and years are likely to be worse. If all of the president's policies are put into effect, kids in the Capital District will suffer more asthma attacks, we'll have more pesticide residue on our food, farm workers will be exposed more to pesticides, places like Schenectady and Troy won't get enough funding to deal with lead poisoning. EPA won't have the staff to make sure that drinking water is clean. And hurricanes like the ones we just saw will be more ferocious. Since the president took office in January, he has been busy reversing strong policies that address climate change. And not only is he reversing the policies, but he's actively promoting the burning of coal, oil, and gas, and extracting coal, oil, and gas, even on our public lands and in our ocean. So here's the deal with tonight. There's not enough hours for me to go through all of the problems, but I want to touch on some of the particularly bad policies, or some that are important that the media has not covered too much. And tonight, I'm calling on congressional members from the Capital District. So that would be Congressmember John Faso, Congresswoman Stefanik, and Congressman Paul Tonko. I am specifically calling on these members of Congress to convene oversight hearings to examine very carefully why EPA is not doing its job. When you think of it, Congress has not repealed the Clean Air Act. They've not repealed the Safe Drinking Water Act. Yet enforcement of these laws are down 60% in the beginning of this administration, according to the Environmental Integrity Project. And I know sometimes members of Congress just want you to look at how they vote on the floor, but so much happens that doesn't get to a vote on the floor. A lot happens in the federal agencies, so we need these members of Congress to hold hearings to find out why EPA is no longer doing its job. They should start on the climate change issue. And then another set of congressional hearings should be held to explain why the Trump administration has been so slow in responding to the hurricane crisis in Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands. These territories were a part of the United States. People that live there serve in the armed services at a disproportionately high level. They don't get to vote for president, but they are American citizens. And the response to their disasters has been completely unacceptable. So tonight I'm going to walk through some very specific policy changes that have come from the Trump administration. And our members of Congress have a long list to choose from in terms of what they might hold oversight hearings on. So let's get started. Buckle in. On day 5 of the Trump administration, the president signed a memo ordering the Secretary of the Army to expedite approval of the Dakota Access Pipeline. Next slide. On day 13, this guy on the far, really the far right, the ExxonMobil CEO Rex Tillerson was sworn in as Secretary of State. You may know that New York Attorney General Eric Schneiderman has launched a very interesting investigation to determine if Exxon concealed information on what its practices had an impact on climate change and their funding of climate denier organizations. So I applaud Attorney General Schneiderman for launching that investigation along with the Massachusetts Attorney General. Day 29, the guy next to Tillerson is Scott Pruitt. He is sworn in as EPA Administrator. Before Mr. Pruitt became Administrator, he was the Attorney General of Oklahoma and sued EPA 14 times, each time he took the anti-environmental position. During his confirmation hearings in the Senate, he was asked, was there one EPA regulation that he could articulate support for? And he could not name one. So the guy over here, Rick Perry, he was on Dancing with the Stars, and he was, which I kind of like, he was sworn in as Energy Secretary, and he became the head of an agency that he proposed to abolish during his failed presidential campaign. He was until recently a board member of Energy Transfer Partners, the people behind Dakota Access Pipeline. Day 55, President announced that he's reopening fuel efficiency standards. You know, when you buy a car today, it's far more efficient, meaning you spend less on gasoline than 10, 20, 30 years ago. That's because the EPA fuel efficiency standards, they kept getting better and better. The president wants to reopen that and perhaps not have improvements in fuel efficiency. Day 64, the Trump administration granted federal permits for the Keystone XL pipeline. This would run 1,200 miles carrying tar sands crude from California to Texas. Day 68, the president visited EPA headquarters in Washington. And I've got to tell you, when President Obama went to EPA headquarters, which he did just a few times, there was a lot of excitement in the air among EPA staff. We were all pretty excited. This time, when the president visited, he showed up to announce that he was going to roll back EPA's signature climate change regulation, which I worked really hard on, not nearly as much as people in Washington, but the Clean Power Plan, would have been the first time that power plants, fossil fuel power plants, would have to reduce carbon emissions. So I thought it was a little mean for the president to go to EPA to announce it. And during the event, he was surrounded by coal miners. Using coal miners as photo ops, what coal miners really need is job retraining. For instance, there are 2 jobs in solar for every 1 job in coal. And what coal miners also need is access to affordable health care. Because when you work in the coal mines, you get black lung disease and respiratory disease. That's what we should be standing with coal miners, to get them good access to health care and good paying jobs. Day 95, the president met with a lobbying group, the National Mining Association. He went to the lobbying group to lobby them to lobby the president to pull out of the UN Paris Accord on climate change. And the next day, the mining association did just that. They weighed in with the White House, urging the president to pull out. On day 98, the president signed an executive order promoting oil drilling in the Arctic and in the southeastern Atlantic Ocean. Next slide. And then on day 140, the president did hold a news conference in the White House, in the Rose Garden, announcing that the U.S. was pulling out of the climate accord agreed upon in Paris. He actually had a marching band attend the news conference. Kind of reminded me of the Titanic. So the thing about the Paris Accord is 195 nations signed the agreement in 2015 to reduce carbon pollution. Name for me the two nations that currently are not part of the Paris Climate Accord.
Well, Syria is one. It's obvious why they're not part of anything. But Nicaragua is the other. And Nicaragua says the accord isn't tough enough. That's why they won't support it.
Right, but that's true. But 2 weeks ago, Nicaragua changed their mind and said in solidarity with other countries, they were rejoining. So this was a trick question. The only two that are out are Syria and the United States. And the United States is the second largest polluter of carbon in the world. Next slide, day 143. After the terrible Paris Accord announcement, EPA Administrator Pruitt did the Sunday morning shows, Meet the Press, Fox News, to explain why we're pulling out of Paris. And he said that since President Trump took office, 50,000 new coal jobs were created. Now, you don't have to be a fancy pants fact checker to know that that's not true. According to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, there were almost 400 new jobs created, not 50,000. And the irony here is that this is about jobs. Clean energy creates far more jobs than burning fossil fuel. If you look at the power sector jobs in our country last year, we had 160,000 in the coal industry and 374,000 in the solar industry. Guess what state has the most solar? No, California. So day 145, EPA announced plans to implement a 2-year pause on regulations that would reduce emission leaks from oil and gas operators. Let's delay that by 2 years. Day 175, the Trump administration approved Arctic offshore drilling off the coast of Alaska. This is an attempt to overturn President Obama's ban on new federal drilling in Arctic waters. Day 178, the Department of Treasury announced that they're going to be supporting fossil fuel projects in developing countries through multilateral development banks. So this will translate in us facilitating the construction of more coal plants around the globe. Day 217, Hurricane Harvey hits Texas and Louisiana and parts of the U.S. Virgin Islands. Just a few days later, Hurricane Irma pummels the Caribbean, including, again, U.S. Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico. They got hit twice, Florida and other states, and then Hurricane Maria. So I just want to pause for a moment on perhaps the most important point I want to make tonight on climate change and hurricanes. Climate change doesn't cause hurricanes. But what climate change does, what a warmer planet does, is make hurricanes much more intense than they ordinarily would be. So you have to remember three things. One is the Earth is warming, and so ocean temperature, Caribbean temperature of water is increasing. The warmer the surface water temperature is, the more it makes the storms more intense. The water is like rocket fuel. Secondly, overall warmer weather heats the surface of the water, causing more evaporation, which increases moisture in the atmosphere. So this brings more rain. So remember when Houston had over 50 inches of rain. And then the third way that climate change and hurricanes are linked is way up in Antarctica, you have melting glaciers and melting sheet ice. That's contributing to sea level rise. And so when you have storm surge, the surge is bigger in coastal communities. So you got it? These are three things. You got to explain it to everyone. If you go to a cocktail party and you don't want to be popular, like me, so how you doing? Yeah, I'm from Rensselaer County. You want to talk climate change? Everyone runs. No one wants to talk about it. So if you want to be alone at a cocktail party, explain the connection between warmer water temperature and climate change. I know it's tedious, but we have to understand that. Day 225, the president nominated David Zetasalo, a former coal executive, to run the Mine Safety and Health Administration. The president has also nominated Congressmember Jim Bridenstine to be the head of NASA. NASA does really important climate change research. And the Oklahoma congressman, if he's confirmed by the Senate, will be the first non-scientist ever to lead NASA. And in the past, he criticized NASA spending money on climate change. Day 238, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission overruled New York regulators and approved the construction of a natural gas pipeline, which the DEC had rejected. So I want to pause just for a moment on this day-by-day litany and talk in more detail about climate change, because it is the issue I am most concerned about. We are at such a serious moment in our nation's history. There was recently an analysis that looked at, so what's going to be the increase in carbon pollution if all of these Trump policies are put into effect, like all of them survive legal challenge? And the scientists estimate that carbon levels will flatten or increase by 2020 if these policies are put into place. So the Trump policies could lead to an extra 500 million tons of greenhouse gases in the environment by 2025. That number is equal to the annual electricity emissions of 60% of US homes. And this is at a time when we should be rapidly driving down carbon emissions. So, you know, the good news is some of the states are stepping up. I think Governor Cuomo has laid out some really good climate change goals, and I'm looking forward to seeing his report on how do we shift to 100% renewables in New York. The private sector is doing more. Cities are doing more. But at the same time, some of the state energy policies just don't make sense. So for instance, Governor Cuomo is providing an $8 billion public subsidy to extend the lives of a few old nuclear power plants in upstate New York. So that doesn't really sync up with a sensible energy policy. So, you know, the reality is not only do you have the federal government on the sidelines, but they are aggressively promoting fossil fuels. When the president's budget was unveiled a number of months ago, reporters asked the head of the Federal Budget Office, Mick Mulvaney, why there's not funding for climate change in the federal budget. And Mr. Mulvaney said, quote, "We're not spending money on that anymore. We consider that to be a waste of your money." So thankfully, we've got state attorneys general, like Attorney General Schneiderman, taking on the climate change issue by suing the Trump administration when they try to roll back things like fuel efficiency standards and other clean energy policies. But it's really gonna be hard to deal with everything that's coming out of Washington. So you all look pretty grim about now. Some of you look like you might start crying. And that's not what you're supposed to do in a speech. And I don't really have tremendous good news, and I'd like to cheer you up, so I brought lollipops. I brought a bag of dum-dums, and some of you will get Tootsie Roll Pops. And I honestly want you to grab one and pass it along.
Start over here. You want to bring one over there?
Yes. So this is just a shameless ploy to break it up. I did this at a New York State Bar Association speech, and the lawyers got really uncomfortable. Like, they wouldn't open the bag. I'm like, open the bag, take the lollipop. And then after a while, I looked out, and it was just a sea of dark suits, men and women, accomplished lawyers, all sucking on their lollipops, and it was hysterical. So maybe when we get like 5 minutes in, if someone could take a picture of the crowd, that would be fun for me. So I just laid out, and you gotta not be real noisy with the rappers. I just laid out the Trump assault on sensible climate change policies, and I wanna shift now to non-climate policies that are being advanced. So on day 10 of the Trump presidency, the president actually signed an executive order that said before any federal agency promulgated a new regulation, they would have to repeal two regulations in their agency, two for one, which I love in the supermarket, but is not sensible policy. Day 36, the president signed an executive order to facilitate the elimination of regulations that are harmful to the environment. And while I was watching, or the economy, harmful to the economy and the environment, as I was watching the hurricane coverage in Florida, I was struck by the number of people who said, after Hurricane Andrew, Florida improved their building standards to make sure that the buildings could sustain hits of hurricanes, and at the time, there was a really big fight whether that was bad for the local economy, but boy, thank goodness they did. Day 56 is Budget Armageddon Day. The president proposed cutting the EPA budget by 31%. Just think about where you work, your school, your business, your organization. Imagine if in 1 year you were told you've got to cut your budget by almost a third. EPA is targeted to have the deepest budget cut than any other agency. And I think it's clear that the goal of this budget is not to save tax dollars, it's to diminish the effectiveness of the EPA, because the EPA budget is only 0.21% of all federal spending last year. And EPA Administrator Pruitt, did I mention he's the worst EPA administrator in the history of the agency? So he wants to shift environmental responsibility to the states. Thank you, Pam. It is a hysterical look you all got going. Who got the Tootsie Pops over here? Ooh, all right. I'm sorry if you lose feelings at the end. Administrator Pruitt wants to shift environmental responsibility to the states, but he proposes cutting EPA grants to the states by 44%. But you all have a role to play. There is a really impressive Save the EPA campaign going on, led by environmental advocates, Food and Water Watch, Citizens Campaign for the Environment, Riverkeeper. I think a bunch of them have tables that you should go visit. And the federal budget is now going to be decided in mid-December. So we have time to convince Congress to change the EPA budget. So you can call your members of Congress and become really active on this issue and remind them that they have a role to play in protecting the environment. Day 69, Administrator Pruitt rejected years of work by EPA scientists and blocked the federal ban on one of the most widely used pesticides in the country, chlorpyrifos. It's a really strong neurotoxin. Thankfully, Attorney General Schnurman and others is challenging that in the courts, But it's really disturbing to think that EPA scientists can literally work for 20 years on a policy, because EPA scientists are really careful and it takes them a long time to get to something. And my understanding was Administrator Pruitt just said, we're reversing that, and he didn't even talk to the scientists. Day 81, Judge Neil Gorsuch, who is not a friend of the environment, is sworn into the US Supreme Court. Day 159, the Trump administration released a proposal to repeal the Waters of the United States regulations, which is designed to protect wetlands. So with all these storms we have, I'm not saying if you didn't fill in wetlands, you wouldn't have flooding, but it would have helped. Like, especially in Houston, where they seem to be filling in wetlands all the time. If they protected wetlands, we could have some progress on preventing flooding. Day 207, the president signed an executive order revoking flood risk standards that President Obama put into place. It was a very modest regulation that said if a project is getting federal funding, you have to consider a sea level rise and consider not building on floodplains. So the president repealed that, but good news, recently he said he may revisit it. I wonder why. Day 208, this is the one that gets everyone groaning. The bicycle docking station at the White House was removed. Day 209, the Trump administration ended the ban on selling single-use plastic water bottles in national parks, which we put in place 6 years ago to reduce plastic pollution. Day 214, the Trump administration suspended a federal study that was going on. Money was spent, the study was in progress to look at risks of residents who live near mountaintop mining removal in Appalachia. There was a tremendous desire to understand, is it bad for your health when the tops of mountains are blown up to access coal? And that study has been stopped midstream. Day 216, the Secretary of Interior proposed shrinking four different national monuments. So, and that's the greatest extent that that's ever happened in history. And on day 240, additional information was released, which shows that the Interior Department that manages national monuments has targeted 10 monuments where they want to allow logging, coal mining, commercial fishing, and grazing. When I was at EPA, one of my colleague regional administrators who had Alaska and Seattle had done amazing work to protect Bristol Bay in Alaska. It's one of the most vibrant fishery in the whole world. A lot of salmon that you eat comes from Bristol Bay in Alaska. And so EPA spent years doing a very methodical plan to protect Bristol Bay. A company wants to do a giant mining project in there. EPA said no, and now EPA Administrator Pruitt has reversed that and has said the mining project can go forward. So here we are, and I actually left a lot out. And don't think for a moment, because you live in New York, that you're okay with all of this. Because you know that air pollution crosses state boundaries, water pollution crosses state boundaries. And I think a really good example of that is, remember the acid rain issue? You don't hear a lot about that anymore. And EPA's role on that was EPA scientists identified the problem, did years and years of research with other scientists, funded scientists outside the agency, identified that tall smoke stacks in the Midwest were sending pollution into the Adirondacks. I remember hiking in the Adirondacks and seeing these lakes that were crystal clear, but no fish in them because the water was so acidic. It was because of EPA science and enforcement of the Clean Air Act that acid rain was reduced by 70%. I'm worried that something like that will be reversed. So now is it the time to turn to the courts? The state attorneys general are doing some really good work, and they need to be thanked for their work. I think, next slide, many of you will remember, that one was just for fun. Next slide, please. I think a lot of you remember pictures like this. This is the Cuyahoga River in Ohio that was on fire in 1969. Next slide. Hold on that one. You might remember pictures of the George Washington Bridge covered in smog. You could barely see it. You remember black soot coming out of the Albany Answers garbage incinerator. If the Trump policies are put in place, make no mistake, we will slide back. And we will slide back at a time when we still have lead pipes in Flint, Michigan. We'll slide back at a time when residents in Hoosick Falls and Petersburg are drinking filtered water because there's still PFOA in their public water supply and they want to drink unfiltered water. We'll slide back at a time when climate change is causing sea level rise and coastal communities have not recovered from Sandy, which the end of October is the 5-year anniversary. And you think of all of the people in the Caribbean that are still struggling. And also, these regulations and rules will be rolled back when we still don't have environmental justice. The reality is if you live in a low-income neighborhood, if you live in a minority neighborhood, there is more pollution than more affluent communities. So we can't slide back. There's too much at stake. We can't accept this. So with respect to David Letterman, I have prepared a top 10 list for you, 10 specific suggestions on what we can do. And then there'll be enough time, I want to hear your suggestions. So number one, regularly contact these guys. Now these two have been really good most of the time, and we should thank them when they're good and call them when we want them to be better. So you've got your two US senators and then you've got your House member. And I can tell you what I've heard from congressional staffers is it's much better to call your Congress member on the phone than to even write a letter. And it's better to write a letter than sign an online petition. So what I've done is put my members of Congress, I programmed it into my iPhone. It seems like a little thing, but it makes it a whole lot easier for me to call. You know, you're driving home, hands-free. Hi, John Bass's office, it's Judith from Posting Hill. What are you doing on the EPA budget today? Just keep calling and get other people to call. And I hope you'll call on the Save the EPA campaign and just go to the Environmental Advocates website, www.eany.org, to get information. You can also meet with your members of Congress. Try it, especially if you go as a group. It's easier, much easier to meet with House members than senators. If they won't meet with you, show up at their public events. Indivisible is really good at doing that. So show up with signs and banners and sing to them. When they do the right thing, thank them. Second tip is stay active on local issues because you have to get some wins and we also have to keep taking care of our local environment. I don't think it makes any sense at all to invest in any fossil fuel infrastructure, whether it's a power plant, a pipeline, a compressor station. Yet just a few blocks from here, you may remember in Arbor Hill, there used to be the Albany Answers garbage incinerator, but it was so polluting, it was finally shut down. Well, get this. Governor Cuomo wants to spend $100 million to build two new gas-fired power plants right a couple blocks away here in Arbor Hill. And it would run on fracked gas. It would operate at the old site of the Answers incinerator. and it would heat and cool the Empire State Plaza. And the way they're kind of stiffing it up is saying that it'll also be a microgrid, which we generally like microgrids, but we should do a microgrid with solar, not with natural gas. So get involved with PAWS, or the Unitarians' own Green Sanctuary Project, and get involved in that issue. My third suggestion is to vote with your wallet. If you own stock, make your environmental views known to the companies that you own stock in. If you're retired, look at your pension fund and figure out where your pension is invested, and don't invest in fossil fuel companies. So here's